But that report has not been, and it's been thrown to the trash can. There's no, I continue to emphasize that there's no amount of palliatives, there's no amount of amnesty and all this thing that you give. Let states control their resources. And the fear people are having is that if you allow states to control their resources, most states will not survive. Then should we allow the situation at the end of every month, every state will come cap in hand, begging for allocation? We cannot continue like that. Look at what is happening now. Government is preaching change. And people are looking inwards. People who travel 3-4 times in a month abroad, you cut down. So if you look inwards, the states will survive. But as long, how did we do it pre-independence? How did we survive? You talk of in Kano, you have the granite pyramids, you have cocoa in the southwest, in the east, you have the coal, you have the coal and tin in Plateau. As we talk, people are exploring gold in Zamfara. Government is not in control. So I don't think there's any state that will not survive. We must actually look inwards, look at the structure of this country and see how we can move forward.
Right, but some people might argue that, you know, that, yes, restructuring could be a long-term solution, but when the people are, you know, seem to push their agitations with violence, is this something that the security agencies should, you know, show that they are incapable of handling?
No. The security agencies, like I said, you know, when we also discussed the issue of Boko Haram, government was negotiating with wrong people, and that's why we will not achieve result. This government came in with its own tactics of saying we must rout out Boko Haram, and I must commend the government. A lot of achievements have been made in terms of bringing down the activities of Boko Haram. We don't anymore see the bombings in Abuja, in Kano. They are now isolated. That's not to say that it's completely routed.
Yeah, but Mr. Jaffa, if for instance,
in the Niger Delta,
if you can hear me, just hang on a minute. If government moves in to stop criminality in terms of this pipeline vandalism while also negotiating with them, would there be anything wrong with that?
No. Government has to, government should not negotiate from point of weakness. But again, we need to look at our options. How are we going to make sure, before we diversify our economy, because that is the greatest challenge we're having now. Government cannot pay salaries because oil prices have gone down. Not only that, our production is being threatened. So how do we achieve results to make sure that before we diversify our economy, we should be able to at least stabilize?
Mr. Jeff,
the point I make is that government needs to be very cautious in the issue of handling this Niger Delta crisis.
Mr. Jeff, the other part of it, while government is being cautious, is a part of intelligence, because we keep talking about intelligence gathering. Is it that the security apparatus do not have enough information as regards who these people are? What level of intelligence have we been able to gather so that we can identify? Because you've talked about negotiating with the wrong set of people several times in the course of this conversation.
Yeah, it's not the issue of intelligence. For intelligence, you don't even require the security agencies to provide intelligence. The most important thing is to get the right people.
How do we get the right people?
There is nothing wrong, like I've always maintained. There are very credible leaders. I don't want to mention names. May so rest in peace. If Alamesia had been alive, I'm sure he would go into the creek. There are people who will go into the creek. There are people who are out there discussing on television. They don't have contact with these people. So as long as we continue to negotiate with the wrong people, the militants will also continue to bomb the pipelines to tell you, well, you are talking to the wrong people. And that's the point.
How do we know for certain that the main faction is factionalized? Because looking at part of the statement they released, they also said that, you know, their leader, Tom Polo, should stop being harassed by government. That was one of the agreements.
Those could be veiled demands, you know, to add credibility to some of the issues they are looking at. So I don't see that as a thing. But as Tompolo complained to anybody that should not be harassed, he's in court, I'm aware of that, saying that he also is enforcing his rights.
Do you also see, even if the Federation were restructured in such a way that, you know, fiscal federalism is practiced, don't you think that the Niger Delta states will still have to cope with this problem of pipeline vandalism, for instance?
That's a very, very interesting question you've asked. Within the Niger Delta, you have the Jos, you have the Shekiris, you have the Robos, and the whole lot of them. So if you restructure the country, it's not going to entirely solve the problem, but we must start from somewhere. So I'm not saying that if you restructure the country now for fiscal federalism, for the states to control their resources, that will bring an end to the problem. What about South Sudan? Are they in peace? But there are basic things that must be done, and we'll continue to give it a try. Pre-independence, we had 50% to the federal government, and to the for derivation, 50%. So if we can, but the military came in and dismembered the Houthi. That was the point. It got to 1% before this democracy that they now started talking about 13% derivation to oil-producing states.
Mike Ejiofor, a former director with DSSI, thank you for coming on the program.
Thank you.
It's back to you now in Lagos.
Well, yes, indeed. And looking through the comments, people just wonder, when will there be an end in sight to all of these bombings here and negotiations tomorrow? Well, that's what we'll draw the curtains today on the program. We appreciate all who have sent a message or two. We'll be back tomorrow. I'm Chamberlain Uso.
Well, we wonder when there will be an end to all of this. Those who will say, each of us can start from where we are, doing our own bit for our society and for our environment. I'm Neil Taber. Thank you for watching.